On this edition of the NESN College Hockey Podcast, we look back at last week's games in Hockey East and all of college hockey, give you our three stars, preview this weekend's games on the NESN networks, and have a little bit of fun, talk about the college hockey alums who we think are going to be the next captains in the NHL. Welcome back to another edition of the NESN College Hockey Podcast. I'm Dakota Randall, alongside always Mike McMahon. Mike, how are you?
Good. It's good to be back. Week two.
It is great to be back. Listen, we had a bit of a soft opening last weekend with college hockey. There was one Hockey East game that was Providence wiping the floor with Maine. You saw that game on NESN. Not a lot of college Hockey East games. There were a few college hockey games. Just, you know, like I said, a soft opening, not a lot. But that really changes a lot this weekend going into next week. We have a lot of great college hockey games. Again, no Hockey East games, so there's no league games, but a lot of college hockey action, and a lot of it can be seen on NESN. And that starts Friday. We have RPI at number 4 UMass Amherst. That game's at 7 o'clock on NESN. Also on Friday, we have number 16 Wisconsin at number 10 BC. We'll have a lot on that game later on in the episode. That game is at 7 and on NESN+. Saturday, which probably is the marquee game in all of college hockey, I believe, as UMass-Lowell unranked at number 1 University of Minnesota Duluth, defending national champions. That game is at 7 on NESN+. Great game. And then going into Tuesday, we have number 4 UMass at number 15 Northeastern at 7 on NESN+. That game is part of our revamped partnership with Hockey East. All of our Hockey East coverage on NESN is brought to you by Rockland Trust, where each relationship matters. So again, another big week coming up in college hockey. We'll get to that in a little bit. But right now, let's just sort of look back at what we saw last week. Let's start with Hockey East, because again, for those of you just joining us, you know, we're going to talk all things college hockey on this podcast, but we are going to have, you know, a decent emphasis on Hockey East. We have the benefit of, you know, being in a region where we have, I believe, the premier college hockey conference in the country. So we're going to focus a lot on those teams. So let's sort of, you know, let's look back at what we saw from Hockey East teams in week one. Let's get it started with our three stars of the week, if you want to start, Mike. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I've been calling it week zero.
Week zero,
it,
okay.
It kind of felt like a soft open to the college hockey season.
Yeah, I'm liking the phrase soft open.
Yeah, soft open.
Soft is kind of like, if you, any, you know, people around the office hear me use the word soft all the time. It's my favorite word to use. So in all situations, so yeah, soft opening.
Yeah, because it definitely wasn't a full slate, but we did have some good games, a lot of exciting action, a lot of goals were scored this weekend in the limited amount of games that we did have. And jumping into the three stars, I don't think it will be a surprise to anybody that we'll go with Greg Prince, the junior from Providence, 4 goals, an assist, and that 7-0 win over Maine. Providence, man, you know, Nate Lehman was a little nervous about the start. Looks like he didn't have too many reasons to be nervous. Obviously, that's just the first game, but Greg Prince...
it had to be a little... Not to interrupt you, that had to be some lip service. He knows how good his team is. He knows how... and his team now, I think they were number 7 in the initial national rankings. Now they're up to number 6, Providence. So yeah, you know, a great game from Greg Prince, as you were saying.
Yeah, I mean, there were questions about where the goal scoring was going to come from there, and I think Prince jumps in and kind of asserts himself as maybe the go-to guy there, and not a bad way to start it with a first star nod from us.
Yeah, and again, 4 goals, that's a good way to get you number 1 star of the week. I'm going to go with freshman Robert Master-Simone over at BU. He had a goal in his first shot of the season. He had an assist, he had 7 hits. Kind of our rookie of the week, I'd say. BU, you know, made easy work of Union. And we'll talk about this in a little bit, but I think Master-Simone probably will get a real increase in workload with the injury to Ty Amonte. So definitely a player to look at going forward. Yeah, a really promising freshman for BU and my star, the number 2 star of the week.
Awesome. A couple different directions I was thinking to go here at number 3, but we'll give a nod to a goalie whose team didn't get a win, but Thomas Vamaka, UConn, 35 saves and a 3-3 tie against Sacred Heart. Obviously not the result that UConn wanted there, but that's a game that they probably would have lost without the performance that Vamaka put up in net. And that could have been a really bad start to the year in UConn. I know there's a lot of people excited down there in stores about what they've brought back, and some people kind of had them as a dark horse on Hockey East this year. So not a great start against Sacred Heart, but Thomas Vamaka with a good performance in net.
Yeah, and I'm not going to say high expectations for UConn, but I think they could be a sneaky team. And I believe they have like a ton of European players on the roster.
Yeah.
I think, like, a majority of the roster a Russian or Czech or something like that?
Yeah, they have a ton of European guys. They have over the past couple of years. Mike Kavanaugh, you know, that's kind of the system that, he's kind of implemented there. I think he's in year seven now there in UConn. So this is kind of like their go-get it season, really. When you think about Kavanaugh's been there for 7 years, he's had time to put in his system. Can they take the next step forward? And you know, I know a lot of people were saying that they're a candidate for a home game in the Hockey East tournament. They're going to have to, you know, get things going, because that 3-3 tie in Sacred Heart is not the best of first results.
Right, but again, it's early.
So it's early, obviously. Yeah. Yes, it's early, but that's all we have to go off right now. We're going off one game.
Right.
So, you know, that's what we got.
Right. So those are our three stars. Now let's just sort of look at the bigger picture with Hockey's teams last week. Again, Providence 7-0 win over Maine. I think Maine is going to surprise some people this year. That's a tough spot for them, first game. Providence is really good. Not totally surprised with that result, but I wouldn't look at that score and just, you know, write Maine off. I think we'll hear from them down the road. But again, nonetheless, an impressive start from Providence. Tell me what you thought about that game.
Yeah, well, you know, Providence, I'll start with Maine, actually. You know, they were able to turn things around in the second half last year. They had a really impressive second half at the turn of the new year. I think we talked about that last week a little bit. But there are some glaring holes on defense, and Providence certainly found them. And you know, while they played another game over the weekend, and while it didn't go on the docket, they lost 5-0 to New Brunswick, who's a Canadian powerhouse for sure.
Right.
But, you know, two goals, you know, two games, they've been outscored 12-0. Obviously, only one of those counts. But they lost five of their six defensemen from last year, and man, you could really tell, because Providence really cut through them pretty quickly. And that top line for Providence, with Greg Prince, Parker Ford, and Jack Dugan, looked really, really good. I think Nate Lehman, he said after the game, you know, they looked like a top line, and they certainly did there. One thing I want to say about Prince's performance was obviously the four goals jumps out. His assist, I think, impressed me more than all four goals he had. He won a puck battle in the corner, went around the net, and he found Dugan on the opposite wing, and just a really, really great play. Showed great vision and great physicality in digging the puck out in the corner and making that play happen. And that only made it 2-0, so that was a big play in that game.
Yeah, I think, I know the play you're talking about, and it was impressive. Prince, really, again, a huge performance. I was really impressed with goalie Michael Lackey. He had 29 saves, big second period, 12 saves. You know, again, Providence can use its talent on offense to sort of get by a lot of these teams that they should beat. But when it comes to playing, you know, the real powerhouses in college hockey, they're going to need their goaltending. And I thought it was a strong debut for Lackey.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, Lackey did kind of bail them out there in the second, because Providence did have a lot of penalties in this game. They were on the penalty kill quite a bit. I know that Nate Lehman wasn't exactly happy with the discipline later on in that game. And also, you know, the questions that we were talking about with Providence, all the young players, I think there's a freshman on every single line that they rolled out. And then a couple pairings on the back end, too. So, you know, I thought that the veterans did a really good job of kind of doing what they had to do, particularly on that second line. Tyce Thompson, I thought, had a really nice game in the faceoff circle. I think he won like 10 of 16 there. He put up a goal. He had a couple assists.
New Jersey Devils, a draft pick, I believe, right?
Yeah, yeah. Yes. And obviously, he's the brother of UConn alum, former UConn player Tage Thompson,
yes,
who's in the Sabre system now. So, you know, some secondary options there. I thought all across the board, there's not too much to complain about with Providence after one game.
Yeah, no. Again, an impressive performance. And you know, first of what I anticipate will be many for Providence and Coach Lehman. Again, not a lot of action for Hockey East teams. UMass-Lowell made easy work of Alabama-Huntsville. Not a surprise there. 5-1 win. I believe Vermont had an exhibition win, if I remember right. Merrimack played two, I believe.
They dropped both their games.
They dropped both of their games. But BU also played.
Lake Superior.
Lake Superior, that's right, yes. Boston University did play as well, and they beat Union 7-3 up in Union. And, you know, it was a good start for to the season for BU, good result, but it came at a cost.
Yeah, well, so
with the injury to Ty Amonte.
Well, beforehand, you know, they found out, it came out like last week, I think it was reported, that Ty Amonte is going to miss the year. That's obviously a big loss for them in terms of secondary scoring.
Right, I shouldn't have said that it came with a cost. I meant more, you know, it's kind of bittersweet because you're going forward now without Ty Amonte for that.
Yeah, team. Yeah. And so, you know, we talked about Mascher Simone kind of filling in there on the second line wing. That probably is a spot that Amonte could have slid into. And so, you know, you're looking at that top line for BU, and there are, you know, Trevor Zegras being the first line, top line center up there, looked pretty good alongside Patrick Curry. So, you know, a lot to like there from BU. I mean, they really, this was a 2-2 game after one period, and they really poured it on from there to get that 7-3 result. They outshot them 44-13, 21-2 in the second period. So a lot to like there from Albie's or O'Connor's team, I thought, in that first game. Yeah. You know, the Dutchmen are probably going to have a down year, but that's still not an easy first game, just a way to start your season, especially when there are so many question marks, especially when you already have injuries to coming into the year. So a good result there for the Terriers to start it off.
And that's not an easy place to play. I've been to that venue. I watched a Union game at Union, and that arena is awesome. That is, it's an old school throwback. It's small, it's loud. You're right on top of the action. And it can be intimidating for visiting teams, no matter how good they are, no matter, you know, what the expectations are. That's a tough place to go into for week one. Easy spot to go in and I think sort of lay an egg or suffer an upset. So I still think it was a good win for BU.
And the Terriers get rewarded with, they get put into the poll this week at number 20.
Right, so. Yes, good point. Yeah, so they are now at number 20. You know, it's kind of hard to see, you know, to see how the Terriers will be this year. Always been a powerhouse. Not a lot expected of them this season, but it wouldn't shock anybody, I feel, if by the end of the season, you know, they're far higher in the rankings, maybe just outside the top 10, just because of the talent and the pedigree of the program. That wouldn't shock me at all. So again, you know, that's a great start to the season for BU. First game without Ty Amonte. We'll see how that goes. Again, for anybody that doesn't know, he's the son of Tony Amonte, who Bruins fans will know him of. Again, not a huge weekend in Hockey East, but you know,
there were some good games out there.
Yeah, good games and notable results.
Yeah, one of the games that I wanted to touch on was Denver pulling out a win against Alaska Fairbanks. I know you brought up that game last week and games you're looking forward
to. I was going
to
say, you kind of looked at me when I brought that up last week, like, why are you talking about Denver, Alaska Fairbanks? And I was saying, something about it just spoke to me, you know, when I saw it on the schedule, I said, I don't think that game's going to be sneaky. And Denver, they pulled out the win, but it wasn't easy.
No, exactly. Yeah, they were down twice in that game. They scored the game winner in the final couple minutes there. So kind of a scare there on opening night. They bounced back with a good 3-0 win the next day. But a good competitive game from Alaska Fairbanks to start the season. That was definitely probably at the top of the docket, I thought, from the college hockey weekend.
I would agree.
That series. And then the other notable game that I wanted to touch on, and there were a few, but Bowling Green going into Miami and taking a 7-4 win on the road against their former head coach, Chris Bergeron. Obviously, this is a game that was scheduled when Bergeron was still the coach at Bowling Green with a team that he brought to the tournament last year. I think it was their first tournament appearance since 1990. So Bergeron leaves. He goes to his alma mater, Miami. He takes over the reins there. His former team comes in and they put up 7 goals on him. I thought that was pretty awesome. Cameron Wright, 4 goals. They outshot Miami 42-19. Just a real dominant performance there by Ty Agner's club. You know, he took over after 8 years
being an assistant. Yep. Yeah.
So kind of a cool result there for Bowling Green to get things going.
Yeah, I thought, and they are, I believe, at number 17 in the polls. So again, I think, you know, they're going to be a good team this year as well. And I guess, as you said, a good start to the season going into Miami and beating them.
Can I go back on the main? The main game for
Providence, like, Maine. Go for it. Providence, what do you got to say?
Well, yeah. So, you know, somebody I was flirting with for a third star this week was a guy who gave up 7 goals in Jeremy Swayman. Who I talked a lot about last week, but the kid made 52 saves. So you know, we talk about those issues with the Maine defense. Swayman is a good goalie. Bruins fans might know him as a 2017 fourth round draft pick. He had a pretty good year last year, but you know, a good goalie goes a long way in college hockey, but it really can only go so far. I think we saw the same thing. We see the same thing with Vermont, with Lekas in goal there, where, you know, goalie can only take you so far. But Swayman, 52 saves. He was standing on his head at some point. He was completely overwhelmed. That main defense, really, Red Gendron.
It's going to be a problem.
Ray Gendron's got his work cut out for him there because It didn't look good.
No, it didn't.
But I wanted to give Swayman a shout out.
An honorable mention, if you will.
Yeah, exactly. I didn't just I didn't want to dump all over Maine for a bad weekend and leave out that Swayman had a pretty outstanding performance.
No, I like it. You know, it's easy to look at that game and go, oh, geez, well, everybody was awful for Maine, but not true. Again, if you watch the game as you did, you can see. Yeah, you know, I think he definitely deserves some love.
And that's what Providence does. Providence plays possession and they pepper the net. That's Nate Lehman hockey, and that's what they're going to do to teams all year, and they really took advantage of Maine there.
Right. So before we get into looking at the week ahead and all the games that are going to be on NESN and around college hockey and Hockey East and everything, I was just perusing the internet today, and I was just kind of looking for stuff that I might want to talk about, and I came across something that I don't know if it surprised me. I didn't really know how to react to it, but NCAA.com did a look at, they sort of talked about or did histories on the five college hockey alums that currently are captains in the NHL. If you were to guess, how many college hockey alums do you think currently are captains in the NHL?
I know the number now, so it's kind of cheating, but...
Right, I was going to say, but if, I
probably would have said definitely less. I probably would have said somewhere between like 3 and like 7, somewhere in there.
You would have been right on because it is 5. So they are Jack Eichel for the Buffalo Sabres, BU alum, Jonathan Toews of the Chicago Blackhawks, obviously one of the elite players in this game, or in all of hockey, from North Dakota, and then Andy Green, the captain of the New Jersey Devils, played at Miami, Ohio, the aforementioned, and then Anders Lee of the Islanders from Notre Dame, and Blake Wheeler, old friend of the Boston Bruins, captain of the Winnipeg Jets, he played at Minnesota. So, I think, again, people might see that and go, wow, only 5, but that's a pretty strong number, I feel. And it also goes to show it's not just hockey. It's like all of college hockey. There's so much parity, a lot of great teams. But it got me thinking, what other, because people look at the NHL and there's so much international flavor, especially with Canada and everything, that you can forget so much good talent comes out of college hockey. And a lot of guys, too, that, they play 3 or 4 years, they get a lot of good leadership skills, and then they make the jump to the NHL and to the pros, and they're kind of, I feel they're more ready or tailor-made to becoming captains in the pros than some of these guys that come when they're 18 years old from Canada. So I just kind of started thinking, what are some players in the NHL that played in college hockey that are next up for captaincy? So we'll just fire a couple back and forth. I'm not going to spend too much time.
I definitely think that number's going to go up.
I agree. That's kind of my larger take with this.
I feel like, that is kind of the point of kind of looking into this, is there are so many more there are more players from college hockey going into the pros, and you're seeing more guys, even undrafted guys who sign undrafted out of college now. That number's like skyrocketed.
Yeah, agreed. That was my takeaway. Is like, I think this number is going to grow, which is a huge testament to college hockey. Which, as again, we talked about it last week. We talked about it this week. The parity and the amount of quality in college hockey grows every single year. It's not just one or two conferences. It's all over the place, and I think it's a testament to the quality of the play in college hockey. So again, we'll just bounce a couple. We're not going to spend a ton of time. I just thought it was kind of an interesting sort of debate. Charlie McAvoy, BU product for the Bruins. I don't know how you feel. I think we kind of argue about this in the office because everyone says, well, it's going to be Bergeron, or it could be Krejci.
It's going to be Bergeron. It's going to be Bergeron. But for how long?
Right, that's the point.
Exactly. It's not like Bergeron's 24. I think Charlie McAvoy is a leading candidate for a future Boston Bruins captain, if you're looking at the current roster right now, unless somebody comes in.
Right. I think there are two on the roster. I think, for me, the more likely candidate, and he's going to be, he's set to be a free agent, but it's Torrey Krug. I think, he's been around longer. I think he does have a leadership role in that team. He'd also be a college hockey guy because he played at Michigan State. Mm-hmm. So he could, he is one of those guys. He could be it, but it depends if he comes back. That's a whole different discussion.
I think his best chance at a captaincy is probably on another team, which, yikes.
Maybe, but if Bergeron and Krejci are gone in a couple years, it could be, I think it could be any one of three college hockey guys on the Bruins. Honestly, it could be Torrey Krug, Michigan State. It could be Charlie Coyle from BU if he signs back on. I think he's kind of got that makeup too. But I thought the way McAvoy handled himself in the playoffs, it seemed to me like this is a guy who's a captain waiting to be.
Yeah, absolutely. It's kind of interesting. The Bruins captaincy and leadership debate is one that you could probably do an entire episode on, because they've had...
You could do a whole NHL podcast on it, right?
They've had such a steady core for, you know, the last decade here.
It's been Char for so long that it's hard to imagine another player.
And then even the guy, I mean, Bergeron's worn an A for I don't know how many years now, and then it's that second A has always kind of been pretty solidified. Like, Torey Krug, I don't think, has ever worn the A for the Bruins before.
No. But I think in the last couple of years, he's taken on a sneaky leadership role. And I think a lot of people look at someone like Marchand too. But I something about Torey Krug, it wouldn't shock me. But again, I think McAvoy is a sneaky captain candidate. So that's, you know, not to make this all about the Bruins, but any, you know, another player that you might see around the NHL that you think has a shot?
I definitely think when you look at guys, I think another leading candidate is Zach Werenski. A Michigan guy in Columbus, back end guy, good leadership. That's kind of what you look for.
Defenseman.
He kind of plays that. He kind of plays that kind of style. That kind of, you know, lends itself to wearing an A, wearing a letter down the road.
Also in Columbus, Cam Atkinson, BC product. I think is a strong candidate too to eventually be a captain there.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, Atkinson, you know, really came on strong. I don't know if he screams captain.
No, but it just, I don't know. You never know as the, you know, if he kind of grows into that role. He's one of the more reaches, I think, on this list.
Right.
He's a bit of a reach, but it just, you know, I think it's a possibility. Makar in Colorado, again, we're talking about defensemen. Obviously, we saw what he did with UMass last year was incredible. And he looked amazing in the Stanley Cup playoffs when he came over. I think he's got all the tools, you know, the makeup to be a captain, like you said, defenseman, but obviously you got McKinnon and Landeskog there, so it might be a little bit of a roadblock.
Yeah.
So, on a couple more players, I don't know if you've got any that you were thinking about. Johnny Gaudreau, BC product in Calgary, I think he's, you know, he lines up perfectly. Also, Noah Hanifin, another college hockey guy in Calgary. So, I think there's a few.
Yeah, there are. Shane Gostisbehere was another guy, defenseman out of Union. Who, you know, has shown a lot with the Flyers there. I could definitely see him taking on that kind of a role. Dylan Larkin with the Red Wings.
I think that's a really good shot.
Yeah, I mean, he's such a big part of that rebuild there in Detroit. You know, it'll be interesting to see how he kind of fits into their core going forward.
I think also Jacob Slavin, maybe a few moves would have to happen with the Carolina Hurricanes for that to happen. Colorado College guy. I think he's kind of got what it takes. Brady Tkachuk, say what you want about him, you know, BU guy in Ottawa, he's got a shot. There are a few out there. Brock Besser with the Canucks, North Dakota guy. But again, like you were saying, just looking at it, I just think a lot of these guys are young. There's way more that we could list going around the league, and more guys that are in college right now that could come into these spots. And I just think, like you said, it speaks to the quality of talent and you know, quality of players and character in college hockey, where I think you could see a lot more captains in the NHL going forward.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I'm sure there are many we missed here. You all can let us know who we missed. tweet at us and yell at us.
Right. It's one of those debates where we were talking about in the office, and you can kind of go down a rabbit hole. You just look at a team and go, oh, you know, what about him? So anyway, I just wanted to bring that up a little bit. I thought it was interesting. Now let's get into looking ahead for the week coming, both in college hockey and Hockey East. The game that I really, as you seem most excited for, is the Wisconsin Boston College game that will be seen on NESN on Friday.
I'm stoked for this game.
Yeah, and you might, I think you're going. You were talking about going to it.
I think I'm going to be at. Yeah, I'm thinking about making the trip out to Chestnut Hill for this one.
So we'll get into college hockey at large here in just a minute, but I want to focus on the Hockey East teams for just a second. And, you know, the BC-Wisconsin game being one of those. We'll get to UMass-Lowell and Duluth in a second. But what about this game are you looking forward to? Is it all the first-round picks for BC, just the talent again, where it's number 16 versus number 10?
Yeah.
Just a marquee matchup.
This is, I mean, when you dug into the college hockey schedule, this is, I mean, there have been really good matchups through the first couple weeks here, but this is the first, like, oh, wow. This is a good matchup.
Right, like appointment television.
Yeah. This is appointment viewing in my mind. And the interesting thing is, you know, here are two top 16 teams. You know, Wisconsin's number 16, Boston College is number 10, coming off of losing seasons.
Right.
Two very storied programs in the midst of rebuilds, for lack of a better term, coming off bad years, with incredible freshman classes. Arguably, you could say the two best freshman classes. There are first round
definitely draft. BC. BC's freshman class is incredible.
So is Wisconsin.
I know it is.
I mean, they have the number 5 pick, Alex Turcotte, who is a bona fide star in the making.
Right.
Cole Caulfield over there at Wisconsin too. And then you look at the 3 first round draft picks for Boston College. Alex Newhook, Matt Boldy, and goalie Spencer Knight, who really seems like he might not only be the best freshman goaltender in the country, he could solidify himself as one of the best goalies in the country by the end of the year. He's that kind of talent. He has that kind of ability. And I wouldn't be surprised if he was one of the best goalies in Hockey East by the end of the year.
Yeah, and this is a statement game for him against a team like Wisconsin, where he can really establish himself, like you said, as one of the best goalies in the country, especially Hockey East, but I think really in college hockey, he's got a shot.
Yeah, everybody kind of always jokes about that, is so-and-so back, but this is a big Boston College back game.
Right, because it's been a little while.
Yeah.
It's been a little while since the Eagles were super relevant in the national scene. And they got the talent this year, but like you said, this is a statement game.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And then, I mean, another thing to look at, Wisconsin has talent. Both teams have talent outside of their freshmen, obviously. David Cotton on BC is a guy that you look at as a Hobie Baker candidate.
Right.
For sure. But Keandre Miller, sophomore defenseman for Wisconsin, 22nd overall pick by the Rangers this past summer, was suspended this past week. He didn't play in their exhibition game. It's kind of up in the air, it looks like, right now, if he's going to play in that BC game. 5 goals, 22 assists last year. Really good ability there on the back end. Really dynamic player. That's the word I was looking for on the back end there. So maybe Wisconsin was without one of their better playmakers.
Right.
How much of an impact will that have? A lot of storylines going in. This early in the season, you love to see that. And I'm very excited for that game.
Right. And again, that game is at 7 o'clock on Friday on NESN Plus. And again, we should mention, we've always had college programming here on NESN Plus. It's always typically been for many people the place where you go to if the Bruins and Red Sox are on at the same time. And you go, one of the teams will be on that network. But this year, we've really ramped it up. We have a ton of college games, a lot of college hockey and Hockey East, but also a lot of other college sports around the area.
We have almost like 100 Hockey East games.
Yeah, like 100 Hockey East games and a ton of all other college programming throughout the year. ACC football, all kinds of stuff. So we're really looking forward to that. So that BC-Wisconsin game is 7 o'clock on Friday on NESN+. Also on Friday on NESN is RPI-UMass. Definitely worth watching. I expect UMass to have an easy time in that game, though. RPI's got a shot?
Well, you never know this early in the year. Last week I was talking about Maine,
right,
how Maine was going to give Providence a game, and it was 7-0. You never know what's going to happen.
UMass is so consistent and solid that
UMass win this game?
Yeah.
Absolutely. But you look at Hockey East's non-conference schedule last year, you kind of say, well, anything's possible.
Right.
There are question marks there in UMass. Obviously they have to replace Kale McCarr and a couple really good players on the back end there. Mario Ferraro, another one.
Yep.
We'll see. I'm interested to see who's in net there to start things for UMass in that game. And
we'll see.
We'll see what happens.
Yeah, that's Friday at 7 o'clock on NESN. And Saturday, one of the other marquee games of the weekend at 7 o'clock on NESN Plus is UMass-Lowell at Minnesota Duluth. Minnesota Duluth lost an exhibition game last weekend to University of Alberta, I believe, which is one of the powerhouse teams in Canadian college hockey, which is a completely other different rabbit hole, as you can imagine. We talked about New Brunswick earlier. So they lost an exhibition game, not a red flag or anything. They put out a lot of young guys, not a big deal. But Minnesota Duluth, back-to-back national champions, enter the season as the number one team in the country. Really the prohibitive favorite. They're just an absolute powerhouse, but UMass Lowell got votes for the national rankings, but they're just outside. They've been a really quality team the last few years. Obviously, Minnesota Duluth is the favorite in this game, but as you mentioned, it's early. You never know. UMass Lowell has a lot of talent on that team. I still think it wouldn't surprise me if UMass Lowell went in there and made some noise. But regardless, I think it's going to be a great game to watch.
Yeah, it's funny you brought up the Alberta exhibition loss. I looked into that because I saw that and was like, oh, wow. One of the headlines I saw was that it was actually a good omen.
Yeah, because they've lost.
Their first national championship, they started that season out losing to Alberta in an exhibition. So they're like, oh, you know, three-peat, here we come.
Yeah, exactly. So, would be the first three-peat since the only three-peat in college hockey history, 1951 to 53 Michigan.
Yeah, the only other team that's gotten close was
Minnesota's Duluth is going for.
The only team that's gotten close was Minnesota. They came up like a game. I think they lost in the Frozen Four, the game before the Frozen Four.
Right.
Somebody can correct me on that. Those who might know more than I do. But
right.
the thing with UMass.
Don't add us. Well, add us if you
well,
want.
No, please add us.
Yeah, please add us.
Please.
Say.
Please interact with us. The thing with UMass Lowell this weekend against Duluth is scoring. I don't know if they have enough offense or an effective enough offense to break that Minnesota Duluth back end. You know, it's going to be tough. You know, Hunter Shepard in net is as good as it gets in college hockey right now.
Yeah, and they returned the whole defense from last season. So they're so tough to score on.
I would say the upset factor is there because, you know, you never know how a team's going to react. A banner's going up. They're doing a pregame ceremony. It's just going to be this whole celebration. It's this whole thing.
Maybe that gets to Duluth a little
bit in the
first period.
Exactly. You never know how a team is going to react to that.
You know, they've done it two seasons in a row.
True. But on both sides, you know, how does UMass Lowell handle that? Does that get them fired up? Are they going to play up, you know, given all of that? You know, you see that happen all the time in hockey. So, you know, I am worried about the offense there. So we'll see. But the clear edge is Duluth.
Absolutely. And again, skipping ahead a little bit, just want to mention more NESN programming. It's Tuesday, Northeastern versus UMass, I think, is also going to be a great game. Two nationally ranked teams.
Well, that's our first big hockey.
That's our first big hockey game. And that's going to be a great one. And that's at 7 o'clock on NESN.
On NESN.
So look forward to that. So we'll get to we'll look at that game a little bit more next week. But I wanted to talk about, you know, college hockey at large going into this weekend.
Because
I think
game that you were really excited about.
Yeah, there are a lot of great games. In particular for me, I'm looking at a home and home with American International in Quinnipiac. American International opens their season Friday at Quinnipiac, and then Saturday night it's at American International. You might remember American International going to the West Regional Final in last year's national tournament, where they lost. But they were the ultimate Cinderella story. You know, they were the darling of that whole tournament. They almost made it to the Frozen Four out of nowhere. Super small school in Springfield, Massachusetts, right next to Springfield College. I'm looking at that game because Quinnipiac, I believe, is number nine. Yeah, the number nine this week. And, you know, what's the deal with American International? Was that a total fluke? Or is there something here? I know there's a lot of excitement over there. They're definitely the class. I believe it's the Atlantic Hockey Association is their conference. They're definitely the class of that, so that shouldn't be an issue. But I know they got off to a bit of a slow start last season. Then they really finished strong, eventually qualified for the tournament. And then obviously they did what they did, going to the West Regional Final. But I'm looking to see, you know, how do they start their season against a really good Quinnipiac team on the road? And then regardless of how that game goes, you know, going back home on Saturday, I'm sure their crowd's going to show out. You know, they have a lot of pride in their team. And I'm really curious to see, you know, what are we going to get from them? Is it going to look like, nah, this was just a fluke? Or is it like, no, we're here as a program, we're here to stay, and we're going to make some noise again this season? I think it's a huge opportunity and a sneaky, one of the more sneaky, intriguing games on the schedule. I'm really looking forward to it. I might make my way out to Springfield for the Saturday night game.
Making the drive.
Yeah.
On a larger scale with that matchup is, those are two teams where you really look at, that's the growth of college hockey right there. You know what I mean?
I remember growing up, Quinnipiac was, I never even heard about them. They were nothing.
Yeah.
And then now they're, again, one of the better teams in all of college
hockey. So that's where you really look at, you know, this is where college hockey has grown, you know.
Right.
The BCs and the BUs don't necessarily dominate anymore. These smaller schools in New England here have stepped up. They've gotten really good players coming in, and they've shown that they can perform on a national scale.
Right.
A really cool early season matchup there between two smaller schools and two, I guess, Quinnipiac's been there for a while now.
Right.
You can't really call them one of the little guys anymore. But AIC for sure, one of the little guys, to see how they can do and how they hold up against a very good, top 10 nationally ranked hockey team in Quinnipiac.
Right. And so that's my other sort of game of the week I'm looking at, along with Minnesota, Duluth, and UMass. Any other games on the national schedule that you were interested in that you wanted to talk about?
Oh, you are putting me on.
No, it's okay. I didn't know. I mean, we've talked about it a lot. I think there are a lot of good games on the slate this weekend. You know, I think the BC-Wisconsin game is the clear favorite, but I know, I mean, again, I think that's not the only one out there.
Yeah, Northeastern goes to Union. You know, obviously we saw what BU was able to do against them. We'll see how Northeastern can start their season.
I hope Northeastern's fans travel for that game, because I would love to be in that arena and have, it's hard to describe to people that haven't been in it before, but the Northeastern has the best fans in hockey, in my opinion. And they travel really well. They make a ton of noise. I would love to see them in that small little barn. That would be awesome. I wish I could go.
Yeah, so and that's another intriguing matchup. UConn tries to bounce back at home against Army.
Right, that's a good one.
That's a must have, really. Yeah, about it for UConn.
Yeah, and I'm really intrigued by UConn this season. I want to see what they got. So I think that's another sneaky
game. They also play against RPI on Saturday. So kind of a big weekend for them. Maine is almost a must win as I think you can get as early in the season against Alaska Anchorage, which is a struggling hockey program right now. That you know, obviously there's a lot going on with the Alaska teams, their headlines, but they got to put up a good performance there after as bad of a weekend to start a season as you could possibly have. So Black Bears fans are definitely going to be wanting to see a lot out of their team this weekend. And then, you know, that kind of rounds out, I think, the intriguing matchups.
Well, we're missing the biggest one by far, UNH at Miami, Ohio.
Yeah, I mean, we'll see. You know,
I don't mean to poke fun, but again, for those this is their first time listening to us, I'm a huge UNH hockey fan. The only time you're going to get completely unbiased coverage on this podcast is when I'm talking about UNH, because honestly, if I'm being honest with myself, I would identify myself, number one, as a UNH hockey fan, and then number two, Red Sox, Patriots, whatever, you know, who cares about those teams. UNH hockey, I was watching when they lost in 99 to Maine in the national championship game, a few years later against Minnesota. You know, I think they got some talent. They lost a lot of close games last season. They brought in Ty Conklin, legendary hockey's goalie, to be the new goaltending development coach. Again, they came in number six in the preseason hockey East poll, six or five, something like that. Not a ton expected of them, but again, I want to see what they got. I think, you know, Miami of Ohio is not what they've been in the years past, but I'm looking forward to that game just as a UNH fan personally. I know you might not be interested in watching it, but I am. So,
hey, you never know.
So let's wrap this up. We need to get out of here. We got other stuff to do. I just want to, again, mention the games that you can look forward to on the NESN networks this weekend. Friday, we have UMass Amherst and RBI and RPI. That's 7 o'clock on NESN. We got BC and Wisconsin Friday on NESN Plus. UMass-Lowell, Minnesota Duluth, Saturday on NESN Plus. And then Tuesday, we have Northeastern and UMass. That's on NESN. That's part of our Hockey East coverage, all that brought to you by Rockland Trust, where each relationship matters. We're really excited about those games. I'm excited. It's going to be a big first real weekend in college hockey, like following what you said, the soft opening. So I'm really looking forward to it.
Yeah, absolutely. Me too. And, you know, appreciate everybody who's back for a second time, who listened to the first episode, came back for more. Appreciate you guys. Keep coming out. Like, subscribe, review, reach out to us on Twitter. Let us know what you guys want to hear. You know, this is for you guys. We want to bring you guys the best college hockey content that we can. So we appreciate you being here,
right.
And let us know what we're doing well. Let us know what we're not doing well, and we'll go from there.
All right, so you can find me on Twitter at Dak Randall. That's where you can find me on Twitter. What about you, Mike?
I am at McWham, McWham.
That's a beautiful handle, McWham.
I'm all right. So proud of it.
All right, let's get out of here. We'll see you guys next week. Thanks for listening.
Thanks for coming out, guys.